So good afternoon, everybody. So we all humans around the world, every one of us has around 10 to the power 14 cells in our body, and each cell has its own genetic footprint. Each cell in our body has a genetic footprinting, which is written in four chemical letters, and these letters are repeated over a billion times, and these letters are what are called as DNA, and these letters make sentences which we know as genes, which are organized into around 23 chromosomes, and the bound volume is the book of life, or which is called as the genome, and we inherit one such book from each of our parents. Now, this book of life is very ancient. It is 100,000 years old when we evolved in Africa, and then on we moved on to different parts of the world. We inhabited very extreme climatic conditions, faced a lot of infection, pathogens, adapted a lot of different kinds of diet or cultural practices, and as a result of which the book has gone through multiple copies, multiple editions, and in each population we are sitting over here, we all look different, we are a little different from each other in terms of the way we speak, the way we are sitting, or the way we eat, etc. So this this human, or the genome is what we as genomic scientists are interested in, because if we understand the sentences or the meanings, then we think that we might have a better understanding of the way we live. And why are we interested? Because you all would know some relative or the other who has either diabetes, asthma, or somebody who is very close to you has a disease, and you would want to know whether you are at risk of the disease. Or better still, if you don't want to do exercise, but you start seeing a lot of your friends going to gym, you want to know whether am I better off not going to gym, or do I actually need to go on and do all those vigorous workouts even I don't like it, or am I naturally lazy? Can I blame it on my genes so I don't have to give explanations why I'm lazy, etc., etc.? So when we are normal, when we are healthy, we want to know, or we want to know what or how we will progress, or if we know that we have a relative, then can we be at risk? Or if supposing the disease we get, would we know that what age we would be predicted to get the disease, or would we progress worse, meaning to the disease? Or even if we have, you might have known some relatives who have a very chronic illness and is on continuous medication, there are a lot of side effects, and managing to live with that disease and along with all those pills sometimes becomes difficult. So one needs to understand that if we can actually have a forecast well ahead of time, then we might have a better quality of life, we can maintain health, and even if we have a disease, we can have a quality of life, or we can hope for that, can I have a customized solution so that I am having an appropriate diet, appropriate therapy? If I am diabetic, should I stop eating all sweets, or can I actually manage a little bit of sweets? So that's what is personalized medicine all about, and it's all about understanding our genome. If we understand what sentences has changed what kind of meaning, and if we can read those sentences, maybe we might aim to have these kinds of answers available to us. But it's not a trivial problem, because when the hope of genome was this, that we have a reference sequence and we understand it and we are done. But what has happened is that all around the world, people have been sequencing genomes with this kind of aim in mind, and now we find that there are around 38 million variations all across the globe. So even between two people who are sitting side by side, there would be 1 million places you would differ. So it would be enormous combinatorial possibilities you would land up in, and if we want to achieve personalized medicine, we would have to find a customized solution for each one of them. Is that feasible? The answer is no. So we want to ask that, could we actually reduce the dimensions, just like, let us say, seven colors of a rainbow? there are, meaning all the seven colors can have other shades also within them. But do we worry about the all the shades, or if we actually are able to get to the seven or some kind of types, we might be able to have a stratified approach. So we are a little better off that we don't treat all the healthy same. There are ways we can actually bin them. So that's what is worrying us, and that's what the challenge is. And who or how you define a healthy human becomes a challenge. And we all know that unless we have a disease, we think that we are healthy. But is that true? That's the kind of question we are trying to ask. So much around this time, around 12 years back when I got into this research, I had a boss, Dr. Brahmachari, who used to come and give me very impossible problems to solve. And one day he came with a note, and he had taken in some meeting, and he asked me that, check it out. You can read in his handwriting that he had written a Prakriti, a kind of a triangle, Vat, Pit, and Kaph written in it, and a question mark as genotype. Being trained in the conventional educational system in India, I had no idea as to what this was. I also did not know where I should go to get this, because I was neither literate in Sanskrit nor literate in what Ayurveda was, because to me, Ayurveda was a system of medicine, but maybe I read it in ICSE ancient history textbooks of Sushruta and Charak, and I did not know of any Ayurveda practitioners. But I had a neighbor who was a historian who knew ancient history, so I asked him what this was. And it was very enlightening to know that actually this was a practice of personalized medicine in India, which is still used. It's Ayurveda, around 3,500 years old. And this system actually classifies healthy people into different prakriti types. So here, there already is a definition of how you can actually classify people into healthy types. Not only this, I got to know that this is actually a system of medicine, which you have a degree, you have colleges, there are nearly 5 lakh registered practitioners. Many of us do not know that there are hospitals around Delhi itself. So it is a system of medicine practiced by grandmothers in our traditional system, but for chronic ailments or for serious illness, some of the people approach Ayurveda practitioners. But like people like us, at this age, we had never heard of it, and so we did not know that there were such kind of people existing. To us, Ayurveda was there. It's what is practiced at home, but not as a system of medicine. This kind of an awareness about Ayurveda still happens to be around. But we were lucky. We actually could spot an Ayurveda doctor who also had a burning desire to globalize the practice and the concepts of Ayurveda. She was Dr. Bhavna Prasha. We got her on board, and from there we started to understand the conceptual correlations or the details or the nitty-gritties of what is there in Ayurveda. So the terms which are given over here is something which we have in our system. So each system you think about has to have a building up, a breakdown, and a transport. And if the system has no balance amongst all these three things, then you might have an accumulation, you might have too much of breakdown, you might have too much of transports. So the body has these three entities called Vat, Pit, and Kaph, which perform these functions in our body and has builds up a homeostasis. So that adequate amount of building up is there, adequate amount of breakdown is there, and adequate amount of transport is there. But what happens is that when we are born, we actually, so these are called as three doshas, and every one of us has each of these components, but in varying proportions. These proportions of Vat, Pit, Kaph get fixed at the time of birth and remain invariant throughout the life. And so if a person who has more of Pit even in them would be Pit Prakriti or Vat Prakriti or Kaph Prakriti, but many of us, mostly we are all mixed Prakriti types, where we would have a little bit of a Pit, little bit of a Kaph, etc. But once we have these constitution types, then it's very easy for an Ayurveda doctor to assess our health state. Because for us, then the disease state is a kind of a disturbance from our homeostatic state. So for example, for a Pitt person, what is a disease would be different from Vata, what is a disease. So as a result of which, people would be treated differently according to what their Prakriti type is. I'll get more into the detail, but what is the interesting part about Ayurveda is that they don't treat the disease per se, but they treat the imbalance in the doshas and get it back to your homeostatic state, which can be a little different for the other person who is of a different Prakriti type. Not only this is thought to be there is a universality to it, because Prakriti can be assessed in the context of which ethnic population you belong to, whether you have a heritability aspect to it, which geographical region you come from. The Prakriti assessment is done in the context of taking all this into account. This is a documented text. I wanted to reiterate. So there are things written as jati prasakta, kulanupatini, deshanupatini. That means there has to be an apportionment to from where you come from, and then you actually assess a person's Prakriti. And that's why it's very global. You can actually take a population, you think that they look nearly similar, but you go and you'll find all spectrum of people, and that can be classified by this system of medicine. And how you identify Prakriti. So there is a very comprehensive way documented by which you can assess a person's Prakriti. You look at the person's body frame, body build, you look at the skin type, you look at the physiological habits, you look at the way the person communicates. So for example, if you were to be of a predominant Vata Prakriti, you might have a thin frame. You might have a skin which would be dry and cracked, you might feel cold, you might be a little more talkative, interactive, quick to take up action, would have brisk movements. And on the other hand, if you are of a Kapha Prakriti type, there is an element of stability, you would have a broader body frame, you would like to have sweets, etc. So this is the way an Ayurveda doctor assesses a person's Prakriti, and once he knows what his Prakriti is, then he looks at what is the imbalance he's suffering from and actually treats them. So this we thought was very interesting, because this kind of a definition was not existing in the modern literature. And what is also more interesting is that once you have know the Prakriti, then pretty much what kind of diet would suit you, what kind of environment would suit you, what kind of lifestyle you should adapt also gets customized around that. Which to us was very interesting, because here we have diabetes and we are given a recommendation, stop all sweets. Or we have hypertension, we are told that stop all salts. Do we actually really need to do that? Maybe we need to take steps, but do everybody, should they have the same solution or would they differ? So here we thought that maybe if we actually integrate these two sciences together, the concepts from one and the methods from the other, and have a new way of looking at how we will sort of have a personalized solution. So that's what we call as Ayurgenomics. But there were two problems. The first was that, as I told you, there was a concept of jati prasakta. So we need to do Prakriti evaluation in a uniform genetic population. Now, Indian populations are very diverse. We speak different languages. And people could well say that I have taken people from three different kinds of ethnic backgrounds, and I'm saying that they are different Prakriti types. So luckily for us, during that time, we were also embarking on an exercise of Indian genome variation, where we were trying to make a map of India as to what kind of populations in India are related amongst each other. So this is the map we came up with. This is a genetic map of India, where people around here are more related to each other. People with the same color around here are more related to each other. So we could get a map. And now we decided simultaneously to embark on an exercise where we take people from the same background and try to do their Prakriti evaluation, because they are coming from the same genetic background. The first interesting observation we made was that we could actually identify people coming from having different Prakriti types. And a little bit of this project got actually funded as an Indo-Russian project, and it came as with a rider that we also have to do this exercise in Russians. So we went to Russia and we did a similar exercise, and in both the populations we could actually spot Prakriti. From here, all Russians otherwise looked similar to us, but we went over there, we actually could spot their Prakriti types. And then we could actually identify who were the predominant Prakriti, because we wanted to look at the end of the spectrum, how do they look in terms of their molecular profiles. So there was a very detailed questionnaire made to be able to get to identify Prakriti, which is there in this website. But what we then decided was then let us ask a question: if the people are different, do they also differ at their molecular level? So what we did was we took their blood samples, we did their biochemical tests, we did their studied their entire genome in terms of their DNA, in terms of their RNA, and asked the question: are they really different? Because they are all healthy people. Now, typically, if you go to a pathology, if you have a pathology test, you actually get some range of normal units, and looking at that, you feel very happy. And then, because you know that if you are in a in this kind of a zone, either you are at risk of a disease, or if your levels are low for something, then again you are at risk of the disease. We asked a question with the biochemical parameters: how do they differ? And what we find was that the Prakriti types actually had a space within the normal range. For example, this is Pith, space for Pith, this is Kapha, and this is Vata. It was not true for everything. For some things, they tended to have different spaces. So you can see that what would be normal for this person actually is this space and not this one. So you are further subgrouping the people within them. And then you also think that maybe these people are in more in the danger zone of this kind of a disease, and these people are more in the danger zone if for a certain kind of disease which have lower values. Not only this, we actually found a lot of difference with respect to a number of things in the RNA in terms of many biochemical parameters, but what was very, very stunning to me, because this is what I had not anticipated, was you see something like a cell cycle, and then we went to the Ayurveda descriptions, and we actually found that 3,500 years back, there were texts written where it says Parmanu Bhed, and the work of Vayu is to actually govern cell division and morphogenesis. We were, meaning at least I was very stunned, and I do not know what kind of instruments they used, but nevertheless this is documented and we have to believe it. Then next we asked was that's okay. Well, we found that there is a concordance. What do we do with it? Is it useful? Because we still have modern medicine, we have modern tests, so how can this help? So then what we did was we decided to take the things further, and we decided to pursue a gene. You don't need to worry about the name, but this gene is an oxygen sensor gene. Now, oxygen is very, very integral to our system, and if we are in a low oxygen condition, our body calibrates itself so that we are able to cope up with oxygen. And this is typically very important in cases like high altitudes. If you go, there is insufficiency of oxygen and you need to cope up with it. Now, what happened was that there was a state where if this was high, then people would be not better adapted to a low oxygen condition. But if the levels of this were low, then there is better chances of adapting to low oxygen condition. What we found was that Kapha individual fell in this spectrum, and Pitta individual fell in this spectrum. So this prompted us to ask a question that could they be differently adapted to different altitude condition, because here are the people who have low of this, and here are people who have this high expression, which means that they might not be adapted so well. So what did we do? We actually took individuals who reside at sea level and had gone to high altitude and suffer from a disease called high altitude pulmonary edema. And when we do that, we actually find that Kapha-like genotype was more present in sea level dwellers who developed HAPE, whereas Pitta-like genotype was actually fixed in people who reside at very high altitude, who have been residing in high altitude for thousands of years. So they need to have maybe this gene switched on all the time. So this actually showed us that maybe Ayurveda-based screening can actually help us identify individuals who would be better adapted to high altitude. Now, this is just a proof of concept. This is just the beginning, because we wanted to see whether such kind of an application can happen. But we were very heartened because people all over the world have also simultaneously looking at high altitude adaptation, and they also spotted the same gene using a different genomic approaches and not this kind of, meaning those were very resource intensive studies, but here it was actually carefully selected individuals within the healthy people from where we discovered these leads. So looking at it, Ayurgenomics seems to be the new, because it was old science for us. We think that it's a lost tradition, but I think I have been able to convince you that maybe we, as Indians, have been practicing personalized medicine, but we have sort of got disconnected from it. So we really do not understand that there actually was a personalized and a predictive approach, which is not new to India. And it also had an advanced approach because it doesn't stop at prediction. Thank you.